and gentlemen, with a resounding round of applause, join me as I bring up on stage. I want the applause to start coming from now. A visionary, innovative, versatile, experienced, charismatic, creative, inspiring, knowledgeable, trailblazing, respected. Please put your hands together for the one and the only Kemi Ogunleye. Well, we're going to be having a conversation on connecting the dots from there to here and everything in between. That's the focus of our conversation this evening. Where you were, where you are, where you want to be, connecting the dots. And it's Chrystallis Conversation. Now, this edition will feature celebrated Chioma Chigul. And as is characteristics of the typical Chrystallis style, this discussion will be heartfelt, authentic, emotive, and highly engaging. Now, the goal of this conversation is to foster an atmosphere of community and connectedness, uplift the audience, and ultimately inspire you to be courageous in the pursuits of your dreams and aspirations. So it's a full conversation, and I'm sure that is one that you do not want to miss out on. So I congratulate you for being here today. And I think you should congratulate yourself by giving yourself a warm round of applause for being here today. Please put your hands together for the one and the only Kemi Ogunleye. You're welcome, Auntie. You're welcome. You're welcome.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. I think between the video that you've watched, some of you may have seen it before, and the song that you heard, I think that's about the introduction that I need. The video sets the stage for Chrystallis and explains why I do what I do. It's really, I'm 100% convinced that the more that we share, the more we talk about the things that we tend to hide, you know, those things, we come from a society where it's like, don't talk about that, don't talk about this. And as I say, people are literally dying in silence. But when we are allowed to speak about, unburden and speak about those things that we've been through, the experiences that we've had, it lifts a burden off of you, but it also helps to lift a burden off someone else as well. And that is what Chrystallis is about. It's a platform and a community for us to be able to share our stories, share our experiences, change minds, destigmatize certain things, and hopefully as we change minds, we can change lives and we can change the world. I believe it's a big dream, but I believe that Chrystallis is going to do it. So thank you all for being here. Thanks for everyone. Thank you, first of all. I'm not saying thank yous now. This is welcome, so I will keep my thank yous later. But I want to say thank you to everyone who's here, everybody who bought a ticket. I appreciate it. Thank you, Auntie Gbemi. Thank you for the stage and the platform. Today, I'm really honored to have Chioma Chigul Omeruah as my... Yes, please. And I'm going to... Thank you. I'm going to pump up my energy. Not that I don't have the energy levels, but I tend to talk a little bit. So today I'm going to really try to be more animated. So you people help me. Bimbo has been helping me. Thank you. I'm going to introduce Chioma now. Chioma Chigul Omeruah. Everyone is here for her, not for me. She's a master of ceremonies. She's a singer. She's a TV host. She's a comedian. I think most of us know her as that. For over a decade, she has explored her many talents in the media and entertainment industry, locally and internationally. In her capacity as compere, Chioma or Chigul has perfected the skills of keeping guests laughing and entertained. She remains alert and attentive as she stares for captive audience through protocol and different kinds of functions. She's a polyglot. That means she speaks, I don't know, when you get up here, you tell us how many different languages you speak. I know she speaks French fluently. I know she speaks Spanish. She also speaks English, obviously, and Hausa. Her command of these languages make her an ideal host for corporate and social events. And, of course, you've seen her in multiple movies and blockbusters. Please join me as we welcome Chioma Chigul Omeruah to the stage.
treat everybody for you. I did just shake pele, but it's a fun tele. Bele, deliver like I get bele. Them say I did go sell you. Them say I did go sell you.
Sorry, I left my phone over there. Chigul. Do you have microphone?
You know, you have to check.
Mic check.
You understand? Yeah. Wait first. Hold on.
Why are you people laughing? She has not even said anything yet.
No, because you have... Look, in this our world, you go somewhere, you check the chair. Hello? Help yourself.
Are you balanced?
Yes, I think I'm okay. Because I have a bad back, so I can't.
Eh?
I have a bad back, so I can't.
Yeah, so yeah. Is the chair comfortable? Are you comfortable?
We are okay.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
So I have to say, I asked Chigul, and she said yes immediately.
Yeah.
I'm very, very thankful to you for saying yes.
I told Auntie Bemi, I was like, there are certain people that will call you. You will not even, your brain will answer for you. Yeah, yeah, I was like, did I say yes? I did.
She said yes, so, and then I think along the way she started having some misgivings that she's coming to come and...
Not misgivings,
was it,
per
was
se,
it just... when we, because we had a pre, I always do a pre-event, I mean, conversation. So was it when we were, after we had that, that you maybe started feeling, what have I signed up for?
I think...
Because we went there in that.
We did. And I've not gone there in my life a lot in this space. I try to... Because, you know, social media, everybody sort of like feels the need to show everything, right? Mm. I want to keep some things for myself. Mm. Yeah, so that every now and then you tell yourself, okay, I know, I'm not going to do this. I'm not that mad. I will just reserve some madness for my, yeah, that is it. Actually.
But I told Chioma, I said, and this is actually your second time that we're having a conversation. We had a conversation during the lockdown.
Yes, we did.
She was my guest on Chrystallis during the lockdown, virtual conversation. So it's not my first time. No, but I told her when we had this pre-event conversation that Chioma and Chrystallis, we either go there or we don't bother.
There's no point.
So we're going to have a conversation that, you know, we all know Chigul, but we want to get to know Chioma. And one of the things, I'm just going to jump right in at the deep end before I get to asking you to tell people about yourself, a little bit about yourself. But, you know, a lot, everybody knows you as Chigul, the
yes.
funny, you know, the comedian, the one who makes everybody laugh. And, you know, sometimes that ability to make people laugh or that comedic, you know, ability can be a mask for all sorts of other things that are going on. Have you found that to be the case for you? Maybe that you started... Have you always been this funny girl, first of all?
Somebody say yes. Let me start. If you know me from before, in this room, just don't say anything, okay? Let the new people discover me afresh. Don't put your mouth. Ifoma, Adese, just if you know me from before, just behave. Just, yeah, help me. Okay? I'm trying to forge a new career. Hello? But in all honesty, and people find this very, very weird when I say it, I think I didn't start to come into who I truly was until maybe my 30s. Mm-hmm. So my whole life, I've always considered myself a yes girl. I said yes to everything.
People pleaser.
I said yes to everything, to everyone, made jokes, used myself as the butt of the jokes, because for me, that was my security blanket.
But you said that was your security blanket.
It was.
What was it that you felt you needed to protect yourself from?
I feel like, because I always felt like they are probably laughing at me anyway, so if I laugh at myself, or make myself look the clown, then I won't feel as bad because I'm already sort of like doing it. Mm. So then if they're doing it to me, I'm not as hurt because I'm already doing it to myself or for myself. Mm. So, yeah, it was my covering.
It was, okay. Yeah. And why did you feel like people would be laughing at you?
So it took me a while to even, and this is the God honest truth, I've never considered myself for a long time, let me say that, I didn't consider myself smart or pretty.
Okay.
I always considered myself the, and I said this to myself, I said, I'm the dumb, funny one. I'm sorry.
Where did those messages come from? And, you know, where do you think those messages came from, that you're the dumb, funny one?
When you grow up, and I think people who know me from, like, primary school, I mean, from my year, like, you're just always the one that's extra hyper, extra funny, extra mimicking. I used to mimic everything. Like, I mimicked everyone. Like, people would come to the house and leave, and then they would be like, how does she talk, Chioma? Do it. And that was me. Mm-hmm. So anybody that, I would give people names, like they would come. Because like we had one of my late father's friends, who for some reason his voice would change in octaves. So I used to call him man with a thousand voices. So whenever he would come, I would say, MTV is here. That's how they knew him. Mm-hmm. So whenever he comes, I'd say, MTV is here. And I would mimic him and his 1,000 voices. So I was always doing those things. I was making fun. I could sing about anything. I had those things, but I didn't consider them talents. I just considered them me hiding behind. Mm-hmm. They were my walls. They were my security blankets. They were my covering, because I felt like that's all I could give
that's
to the world. That's all I had.
So, and how were you doing in school, academically? Were
very
you
badly. I was failing so much. Failure came to me and said, please mentor me. Look, I had a master PhD in failure. You know when you fail so much, like I think I took WAEC like maybe 3 times. I failed Igbo. As in F9 in Igbo language.
Fully failed.
I speak it, I write it, but I failed it F9. And sadly to say, I can say it now, the invigilator at the time happened to be my uncle. Who was telling me shade B, I was shading A. He said, come on, this is shade A, B, in a shade A. And I still failed it F9. That tells you my skill of failure was wow. Yeah.
But you see, so this sort of makes me think about the fact that, you know, different types of intelligences are not...
I didn't know my own.
Yeah.
My intelligence was failure. It's an intelligence.
No, but, you know, you were obviously intelligent. It takes an intelligence and talent and skill to be able to watch how people act and recreate it, to be able to mimic, to be able to do so many different accents that you do. What you do comes so naturally to you is something that is actually an intelligence, etc. But because in school we tend not to test for those types of things anyway, so there seems to be only one type of way to be intelligent. And so for those children who grow up who are not within that narrow box, they may end up, you know, like feeling the way that you feel, because there's no validation for what they do, for the gifts that they have. And I think the reason I'm saying this is because somebody may be listening to this for whom, you know, that penny needs to drop.
They might be intelligent like me. That's our intelligence. It's a special type.
You're clearly doing well for yourself now. So somehow, you know, you've
I think I realized this in my later years that, oh, I am smart. I am intelligent. Because as far as I was concerned, I was just Chioma, who was just...
Faffing around,
who didn't like school. I mean, I like my life free of stress. So I was the one who went to college in America, and the books were too heavy, so I didn't go to class. Like, I was like, oh, psychology, I can't.
I can't carry these books.
Oh, sociology. Because my father said I should go and study law now, so I should go and study criminal justice and be a lawyer. Because in his mind, in his vision, he saw me as a lawyer. He said, you talk a lot, so go and be a lawyer.
Yeah,
it's okay.
Absolutely.
So I went to America, and I showed them Pepe on failure. No. I was on academic probation. They sent me a notice, if you fail again, you're going home. That's how bad it was. So.
And then what did you do?
And then my father called a meeting of all of my uncles across America and said, I don't know what we're going to do. She's about to be kicked out of school. What do we do? So my mother looked at me and said, go and learn something. You are good with languages, but go and study French. I said, but she said, just go and learn it. Just go. Just go and do something that will help your GPA to climb. Mm. So I went back to college and I re-registered. I changed my major my sophomore year, second year, to French education. So my GPA crawled from 1.5. Don't look. it crawled back from 1.5 to a 3.1. So people graduated magna cum laude, summa cum laude. Me? Thank you.
Cum laude. I mean, it's incredible, actually, to climb, to pull up, and what it takes to pull your GPA up from 1 point something to 3 points.
That's when I realized I had it. Had small
that
gifts.
You haven't. Yes. So it was just a matter of that finding where you were supposed to be, finding what it is that brings out the intelligence is there. But I want to go back. She was dropped in at the deep end. To you as a child, what were your aspirations? You know, you said your father wanted you to be a lawyer, but what were your own aspirations as a young child?
As a little girl, I always wanted to be a pilot until I got to school. And then they said, you have to take mathematics. Then my piloting
flew away.
The pilot flew away. Yeah. So then I just said, you know what? I at the time, I was like, I want to be, I think I was like, maybe this lawyer thing, maybe it'll work. And then when my dad said to me, he was like, just, you talk too much. So you must be a lawyer. Because we're four of us in the family. My two brothers studied accounting. My younger sister is a doctor. I was the only one who was a prayer point. I was my parents' prayer point. Please let Choma do well
in life,
in one subject at least, so that we can move on. So when I was like, I wasn't sure exactly sure what I was. So you can call me undecided. So it wasn't until I think when I did French and I did well in it, I now decided, okay, there's something here. And then I started acting in the U.S. I was doing theater, and it was more like absurd theater. So it was more on the funny side. Mm-hmm. But I saw myself acting, so I liked to act. And then I was also singing a lot because I've always been singing. I used to sing jazz. And so I was like, oh, okay. So these are the things I would like to do if I ever had a chance.
Right.
I even wanted to go to New York to go to Broadway. That was a plan. Mm-hmm. And then it was after September 11th, I was like, oh, it's like the plan is going to change. Yeah. So I didn't go anymore. And then my father calls one day and says, come home.
Yeah.
Did he ask? They don't normally ask. Yeah.
You were already working at that time.
I had just lost my job.
Oh, I see. Okay.
I was teaching high school, teaching French in high school in the U.S., and then, you know, this our paper problem. Say, you don't have paper. When I went to school, I told her, I said, Ma, sir, I don't have work permits. So I've left school. They said, no, don't worry, we'll get you, you know, we'll sort it out. You know, we just need you to start immediately, like tomorrow. So I started working. Mm-hmm. So the HR director kept my passport for like 3 years. So one day, just by happenstance, I said, let me just enter this school district. I asked them a few questions about next year. So we just started having a conversation with the district chairperson. Then she was like, oh, so you don't have a work permit? I said, oh, no. She said, really? I said, mm-hmm. So then she was like, oh, give me a second. My dear.
The next second.
Look, listen. I said they found my passport under a stack of papers. Like it was under the under. She said, oh, your passport's here. Mm-hmm, it is. What next? So in my mind, I'm praying. She now says, Miss Chi, I'm sorry, but I don't think we're going to be able to renew your contract for next year. So I walked out of the building unemployed. I had to leave the house I was in. I moved into my friend's house. I was sleeping on her floor some days, on her chair other days. There was no food sometimes. There was no heat. So we'd turn on the oven to heat the house because we couldn't afford to pay for heat. So then you start doing these odd jobs. So I got an odd job as a housekeeper. Housekeeper cook for a family of five. A very wealthy family, a black family of five. And I would go to their house at 7 o'clock in the morning, wake up the kids, wash, do like five loads of laundry, iron, clean all the bathrooms, scrub the house, walk the goddamn dog. Can we say damn?
You sure can. You said it already, so.
I'm sorry. Walk the dog, wipe after the dog. So one day I was playing with the little girl, one of their children, and she spits in my face. Listen, you know when there's a target? Yeah, she spitted. Lopon the face, near my mouth. So I wiped it off. And you know, the family was like, you know, we don't yell at the kids. We tell them why they were wrong and we explain things. Satan said, jack her up. But God said, don't do that. They will deport you.
You already so, are yeah, leader somebody. Yeah.
So I had a moment. I went, I called my mom and I was crying. I was like, I can't do this anymore. And my parents didn't know what to do because this is not Choma's normal behavior.
Yeah.
So then my dad calls and says, all right, come home.
Okay.
You're done.
That makes sense. It makes absolute sense why they said come home.
Yeah. I was going anyway, but I was like, you know.
So I know that when you came home, you know, certain things, let me allow you to continue. What happened after you came home? What was the plan for coming home? And then what happened next?
Kemi, you know, just look. For anybody who has lost your parent, I don't care how old you are. I don't care how much strength you think you have. I came home and my dad was traveling to the UK on business. And I remember I was practicing for a play. I got a part in a play. And so it was, this is me. Daddy, bye. Buy me something. I was joking.
He said, you just come back.
Yeah, I just come back. He was like, go, Joe. You'd have not seen since you've been back. And my father flew to the UK, and that was the last I saw of him because he died in the UK of a heart attack, apparently. And when that happened, when people ask me what that did to me, I don't know about anybody else, but you feel like you are naked in the cold because your covering is gone.
Yeah.
So my covering was gone. This is the person that made sure that I was okay in life and all of us were okay. And all of a sudden, you're faced with how do I continue life when this person is not there anymore? This person provided financing. This person provided a house. Everything. And
he provided a plan. He said, come home.
He and I were supposed to go into business together. He went and got me classes at Lagos Business School. I fulfilled, Sha, but thank God he didn't waste the money too much. I would have failed it too. But he said, go and take business classes. I said, oh, let me go and take. And then this is what happened. And my life was thrown into absolute chaos. Absolute chaos. I didn't even know how chaotic my life was until I started the journey. I woke up the next morning, and when I saw that I was still alive, I said, okay, so God, you have a plan. That's what I said to myself. I said, okay, you have a plan, all right, so let's go.
I think you're right. There's something about, I mean, for anyone who has lost a parent, especially, I mean, at that time, earlier years, when you're still relatively young, still trying to figure out, I don't think you ever really get over it. Like I always say, you don't get over it. You just learn to get on with it.
Time just makes it more tolerable.
Yeah.
Doesn't heal a thing.
Time doesn't heal anything. Yeah. In fact, I was saying to somebody just the other day, my mom died 25 years ago, and I was talking about her. And I found myself tearing up. And it was a very random thing. It wasn't like I was talking about how my mother died. I was just talking something about, and next thing I knew, so it's like,
oh. I cry every single time I think of my dad. Mm-hmm. Because we talked about, my father was in the military. If anyone knows my dad. My father didn't make complete sentences. He just said one word. You just automatically understand. Because he said to me, as I turned 30, he said, oh yeah, what next? I said, meaning what? He said, you know, women, at this point, you know, shelf life, you know, is low. So what next? AKA, Marianne, Pompikin. So I took it as though he said, you need to think about those things. Mm-hmm. And when he died, in my head, I said to myself, and I don't know if anybody else feels this way, but when we went to the village to bury him, as I walked into the village house, I said to myself, the next time we come here, it has to be for something happy. It has to be a celebration. And it's probably be my wedding. And that's what I said to myself. And it was.
So is that, because you got married, how long after your dad died did you get married?
My dad died in 2006. I got married in 2009.
So when you were, you know, the decision to get married at the time, do you feel that there was any sort of that in the back of your mind of this is something my dad wanted me to do and so this is something that I
wanted to do? I was like, he wants this. He wanted this for me. Yes, I knew the person. So it was like I just found one man off the street. And we knew each other. and the families knew each other. So I was like, for all intents and purposes, this should work. Right? Mm-hmm. So I was like, hey.
Why not?
And you know the thing about this, when we met, it was like film. Like, we were at a gathering, and then I looked up, and he's at the other side of the room, and he looks up, and then we see, like, Indian movie. And I mouthed his name, he mouthed mine, and I said, like, we'll talk later. Like,
And that was it.
And from then on, I told him, I said, okay, so after this, we've met now, we should cut a year or so. He gets to know me, I get to know him, how he is. Then we should marry after like a year.
Which is what happened.
That's exactly what happened.
So many people don't know. I don't think many people know that. I don't know how many people actually know that Chioma has been married before.
Uh-huh.
She's not married.
Not anymore.
Not married anymore.
I'm still in the market. Hello, please. Shop is still open. Hello. We are still...
She's still very much in the market, yes.
Yeah.
In the market.
Listen.
So, but you know, the decision, like you said, to get married, you married him, you know, what do you think now, looking back, how long were you married for?
Let's see, because you're trying to judge at what point. Like, I would say I was married for about 2 years, mm-hmm. separated for about 6-7 years, as in, yeah, couldn't do a thing for about 6-7 years. And then finally got my divorce in 2015.
Okay.
Yeah.
So at what point did you start to think this is not working?
First of all, I had just got my job in Abuja, in ECOWAS.
So you were in Lagos?
Because I was working at CIS. I was teaching French at CIS.
Yeah.
Taught there for 3 months. Got the job in Abuja as a translator at ECOWAS. Moved to Abuja. So the plan was we're going to move to Abuja. And, you know, that's the plan. You know? It's like film.
So both of you would move to Abuja.
I'm just going to go to Abuja. We'll just, you know, kids will be in school. We'll enroll them in school, you know, and have a nice life in Abuja. Yes. That was the plan.
That's the plan both of you had agreed.
We discussed it. Yeah. We discussed it. We said, okay, this is what we're going to do. It's like, okay, fine. But I think as time went on, because I remember for 1 year, this was my schedule. I would catch the 6:45 Aero Contractors flight from Abuja to Lagos. And then I would catch the 6:45 Aero Contractors flight on Monday morning from Lagos back to Abuja and go straight to the office. I was doing that for 1 year straight. Straight. Every weekend it was.
So your husband was not coming to Abuja. You were coming
not
to Lagos.
Not a lot. I think he came maybe like 3 times, 4 times, something like that. So it wasn't, but something just said to me, and I think this is what we're told. You hold your home, you build your home. So almost like you make the sacrifices mm-hmm. that need to be made. Mm-hmm. And that's what I allowed myself to believe, mm-hmm. and thus I was doing. And in my mind, I'm going to do what I have to go do to be with him on the weekend, since we can't see during the week because we're both working. Mm-hmm. I'm out of Lagos, he's in Lagos, so yeah.
So do you think the distance took a toll, or... You know,
I think it did. Mm-hmm. I don't think it is the main factor. I think it just added to the list of things that didn't help matters. Okay. But at the end of the day, I still feel like two people decide. If you decide, then you decide. And you navigate those waters together. Mm-hmm. That's what I believe still.
Okay. So at the point where you figured out, well, this isn't working, or this marriage is not working, how did you navigate that? What kind of support did you have? Sorry, can you guys hear me? Yeah, okay. What kind of support did you have at that time?
I feel like, and I know that there are a lot of, some of our mothers in here and, you know, and people who are like me, but I feel like our parents, like my parents at the time, my mom at the time, I believe she was doing what she thought was best to do. Mm-hmm. She was doing what she knew to be the best thing and the best way to advise me. But I didn't get that, I'm with you, what do you need, I got you, let me help you, can we talk about it? I always felt like it was like, go and hold your home, go and find your husband, go and get your husband back. And then there was a point where he actually said, I'm not doing it again.
He said?
He sent me a message. It was a test. Test message. I don't want. I said, wow. Just like that. It was like a memo. The marriage have finished. Do your worst. I don't want again. Yeah. So it was done. It was done.
But your mom still felt there's something you can do. You know, it's your responsibility.
I was just told, go and hold your home. My mom and my aunties, I love them dearly. But it was, go and hold your home. Go hold your home. That's what I was told. That was the exact line. Go and hold your home.
Yeah. And how did that make you feel?
You sort of feel very, it's a strange thing to describe. Because at that same time, I now found out that there was a child involved.
He had a child.
Yeah. And how did I find out? I was in my office. I just said, let me call his cousin. Because I had been, you know, I've been hearing things, saying, like, I don't know. Let me just call a cousin and ask. So I called the cousin and I asked. And he said, yeah, we thought you knew. How did you thought? How such a thought? That I, how did I knew? Am I a winch? How am I going to knew? But the truth is, even in that, I had told myself that a child is a child. So I would have gotten over my issues and just rolled with it.
So even in that, you were still ready to make it
as long as the mother is not dramatic, we can have a blended family. Let's be going. Do you understand? Baby mama drama, I don't want. But if there's none,
if there's no drama, we can figure out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it was one of those things. But all of that is now, we're very cordial now. So we're in a very good place. Because all the time we weren't speaking at all, but we're in a very, 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 very good place,
good
right
place
now.
Yeah. Which is what I wanted. So I wanted to ask you, you know, obviously the sense of he had a child, you didn't know, betrayal. But was there also the sense of you hadn't had a child? And did that also, how did that also?
Whether you like it or not, it pinched me weller. I mean, I'm an amazing auntie. I'm the best auntie ever. I'm an amazing babysitter. The children love me. I mean, I carry a child, they just go to sleep on my body. Plus, I have a cushion body, so it just helps matters. But at that time, and it was really weird for me because he was my first everything.
Yeah.
At 33. I used to call myself a rusty, crusty virgin. I was a rusty. Like, you had to do spring cleaning because cobwebs inside everywhere.
So you had waited that long. You had done everything right. Everything exactly how you had been told to do it. And
I didn't,
It didn't click.
It didn't work out like that. So, I mean, I literally had to get to a place where not having a child, it was a cloud. And I carried it everywhere I went to. Even in this job I'm doing now on social media, because people are mean and they're like, go and have a child. You're not going to born. Your mates have had children. You're sitting here doing funny. Go and marry. Go and born. They say that to you.
Yeah.
You know, I've had these comments come at me all the time. So, yeah, I didn't have any children. And I'm at the place in my life where at 40-something, I don't know if the factory, you know, is going to be... Yeah. I don't know if the egg, she might be scrambled at this point. I don't know. Poached egg. I don't know. So,
the thing with Chioma is you're trying to be serious and then she just...
No, but it's the truth. So you battle with
these things.
Is this
something you've made your peace with, that if this doesn't happen, or are you exploring other ways of making this happen?
Like, my prayer now is if I meet a guy, I'm on WhatsApp, hello. I'm on Facebook too. I hope he has children, so there's no pressure there. Mm. But I mean, I would like to adopt. My dream is to be a foster mother, actually. I have a dream of, I want like 10 children in a big house that I'm raising them, sending them to school. Mm. We're sitting down together at the table. That's my dream. And I don't care where they've come from. Let's just come and just maybe transition through me into the world and just be productive citizens. And that's literally my dream.
That's Has this always been, have you always dreamt of being a mother?
Kind of. I mean, thanks so much. I've always, I think I'm good at mothering. I'm good at nurturing. I think God has given me a gift of being able to help with developing and growing people. And I think that's just who I have been called to be, and part of the assignment that I have on this earth is, so making impact for me is, whether it's it's through this foster system or helping children or helping people, just being a better person. You know, and there are so many children in homes who are looking for parents, mm-hmm. and so you can go and do bend down select. Let me just take, let me have a kid, just one kid, just a little Wait. Kid, yeah.
I mean, I actually think it's going to happen for you because I do see you in that role. I think that I've always sort of seen you as, in spite of funny, you do have this very strong nurturing side to you. I see how you...
I mean, it'll be mad, but we'll get through our madness together. It'll be insane because I'm a little touched, but, you know, we'll get through it. God will help us.
Yeah. Yes. And you're kind of mothering your nieces and nephews.
Yeah. I am the bomb. See, eh? Listen, my auntieship. Listen, my auntieship. Best
in auntieship.
Yeah, I should have a word. Yeah, I'm an auntie of life. Yeah.
Oh, Chioma. I wanted to ask you, actually, you said earlier, I'm going to go back to something you said earlier, where you said you've always been a people pleaser.
Yes.
You know, it's something that you've always been. And I feel like a lot of women have that need to be liked and for external validation. Mm-hmm. Where do you think, maybe well, personalize it for yourself, where did you feel like that need to be liked came from? And is it something that you still deal with today?
Yes, especially in this career that we are in. Mm-hmm. Because it's very people-oriented. So relationships is what gets us. Sometimes the parts you're asking for, the work you're doing, it's because somebody knows somebody who knows you and things like that. I've always said yes to everything and everyone. I'm the one, even in America, like if my friends were ill, call Chi. Chi will come stay with you and nurse you back to health. Mm. That's what I used to do. And I liked the fact that I could bring joy to someone or succor or help or support mm-hmm. to someone. But I also had to learn that in my giving, I lacked wisdom. In my loving, I lacked wisdom. Mm-hmm. In my being there, I lacked wisdom because I gave so much of me, there was nothing left of me for me.
Yourself.
There was nothing. So I literally was running on E. Mm. And I couldn't give out of an empty tank. So I was now scraping the bottom of the barrel, still trying to give when there's nothing left. And I'll be this E. The E was blinking. I don't have again. I don't. There's nothing said. She stop it. Stop. So, but no, we have to still. Yeah.
Did you ever feel resentful that maybe people were not giving to the same extent to you? Because sometimes for people who give a lot, you expect that same energy, as they say, or that same reciprocity from people. Did you feel like you were not getting the same thing from the people that you were pouring out so much for? And then also, how did you learn to start sort of drawing boundaries so that you could, you know, also nurture yourself?
If you ask my family members, they'll tell you I've not drawn the boundaries yet because I'm still being foolish in some ways. But we thank God we are trying. We're working in progress. We're not perfect. But I stopped looking for reciprocity because I believe that if you are giving, give without expecting anything back. Because that's where the blessing is. Mm. So it was about do I want to be seen doing good or is I doing good to be seen? Mm.
Do I want to be seen?
Do I want to be seen doing good or am I doing good to be seen? So I realized that when you see the people that are better because of you, that helps build me. Mm. That gives me some joy, gives me some confidence. I've seen somebody go from really bad to, even if it's just a little better, because I was in the picture. Mm. So for me, that's all, literally all that I need. Because, and a lot of times, it comes back to you, whether you like it or not. You see this thing called, they say karma. But I believe it's just how the world is. When you give, it will come back to you. So I've always been the one. I mean, you know how Enyi is. Enyi is my brother. You know who he is. And so Enyi's always taught me. And Enyi's always said to me, my older brother, who's my manager, we used to talk and he would say, the one thing you always have to do in any situation is bring value. And one day, that value will pay you back. So that's how I live my life.
Awesome. right. You are an Ada?
Yeah.
Okay. First daughter.
Yep.
I wanted to touch on that one because I think, obviously, first daughters, I'm not a first daughter, but I know that first daughters have a lot of pressure on them to be perfect, to be the standard, to take care of everybody else. Which might kind of play into that need that you feel to take care of everybody else. But I also wanted to touch on, you know, the relationship that maybe you had with your mom, because I know that sometimes with first daughters or with daughters, there can be that tension between, you know, your mother and yourself as you try to, you know, define yourself outside of your mom. What is your own personal experience with that?
So if anyone knows my mother, she's the exact opposite of me. People know her. My mother is quiet. My mother is very dainty. She's, you know, she's nice nails, and she's, you know, sits down and crosses her leg, and she's, oh, you're talking too fast, or, you know, oh, Chioma, who will marry you if you're talking like this? You're so rough. And I'm the total opposite. And the main things that always caused friction between us as I was growing up was, one, schoolwork, because I was failing badly. I started failing since. So I had practice from primary on. I was failing all the way. That and then my weight. So we clashed over my weight every single time. When we were in school in America, she would come. And you know, you just know when you first see your parents and they hug you. Oh, did you? So did you add or did you lose? I don't know, ma. I don't. What do you see? How is it doing you in your eye? You know, so it was one of those things. Like, then she would say, you know, after she was like, okay. And then she would say, sorry. I didn't mean to say it like that. So, you know, what I'm saying is, I just don't want you to. I said, mommy, I'll be all right. I'll be okay. It's okay like that. Don't worry. Mm. So we always clashed over that. But I've also now come to a place in my life where I love regardless. And I think we, as I've grown older, we respect each other more. Mm. So, and I don't live in her house anymore. So that's even better. When you live with them, it's different when you're in their faces 24/7. Mm. Like you come home and you're here. Because when I moved from Abuja, I had to move back to her house. So I was in her house all the time, every single time. So she saw me, maybe you'll be trying to dress quickly, so she won't come to the room and see you. So you wear your clothes, maybe you wear shapewear, deceiving yourself. You can't breathe. You are wearing ghetto. You cannot breathe. Deceiving yourself that, oh, maybe she'll see it, and then she'll be like, oh, you've lost more weight. Ah, see? Life.
Or maybe she'll catch you when you are eating.
So like, I'll run downstairs. This is what I did. I used to run downstairs. And I'll tell the cook to make me food real quick. And I was like, now, she will hear clank, clank, and it's as if she will hear clank, 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 clank. She will come down and say, I finished eating. What did you eat? Like, I had one egg and a slice of wheat bread. I just finished two indomie. Yeah, look, excuse me. Listen, I don't like stress in my life, okay? So, I just finished indomie with egg. It was good. I enjoyed it into my soul. I was dreaming about it when I left the house. But I told her I had one egg and a slice of wheat bread. She said, that's nice, that's good.
Mm-hmm. And she didn't believe you, by the way.
No, I think she did, yeah. Because, you know, are we going to fight about it? Are you going to open my mouth and check? That's my truth. So in my mind, the indomie
has turned
was
to.
Transferring the wheat from the indomie, began to somehow form as a bread. Yeah, then the two egg joined the yolks. Met and said, we are one egg. So I had one egg and wheat bread. Allah, indomie.
Leave me, please, I beg. I like the fact that you said you've learned to respect each other, and that, you know, clearly.
I love her dearly, love her dearly, yeah. I love her dearly. So I like going to drop by the house and visit. Mm. Then she said, when are we see you again? I say, I'm coming. Give it 1 week. I like doing things for her. Like, I like sending food. You know, she's like, what do you want? I call her, do you want breakfast today? And I'll send something. So those things, you know, bind us even more.
Do you understand her better? Maybe her struggles, maybe why she was, for example, your weight or, or, you know, trying to get you to do better at school or whatever it was that may have the time you didn't quite understand it, but maybe as you've grown a bit older, you understand where she was coming from or why her own particular struggle sometimes, because I think parents project onto their children, especially onto their daughters, mothers too.
But my mother was also a brilliant person. Mm. Like when she graduated, when she did her master's, she graduated and she got the president's award.
Wow.
I don't do that. We just, that's not our calling. Mm. For the love of Jesus. We just, the president can call us and be like, can you sing at the event? So he's not going to give us the award because we are barely making it. So it was always one of those. And my dad actually used to say, your mother is brilliant, your father is brilliant. How can you be so dull? I don't have answer for that. My answer was my action. I give you another failure. That was the answer. And I think, but I realized I just didn't apply myself.
Right.
I was very restless. That you could not pay me to sit still. You could not pay me to sit still. My father tried this. And my father was a very strict man. Sit down. Put your hands together. I went to military school. It did nothing. It was just not in the calling. Mm. God said, be thou restless unto Israel. Oh, thou restless one. Be thou restless unto the world. Restless away. So I restlessed myself.
It's who you were.
Exactly. And I realize that now.
Yeah. I guess are you more comfortable with who you are now?
I'm getting there. Mm. I'm getting there. Mm. Small. I'm getting there.
Because I know, you know, again, this weight loss journey. You were talking a lot about it in 2020, mm-hmm. during the lockdown.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a journey. What has the journey been like?
I laugh in Spanish. Hold on. So you know how people say, I fell off the wagon? No. I said, wagon, stop.
I want to come
then
off.
Then I came, no, I didn't even tell it. I just came off the wagon. Then I used my hand to push the wagon to the cliff. And I say, wagon, fall down. The wagon die. So the wagon is somewhere on the ground. I decided to use my leg and trek. Whatever I see, hello, we are going. So let me stop playing. I'm still a work in progress with regards to my weight loss, but I have PCOS, discovered that, and I had a situation with my back that put me out of commission for about 2 years. I was wheelchair, walking stick. I had to take injections every day because I had an infection in my spine that I didn't know about. So I was just walking around like a mad person, in pain every day. I was in absolute chronic agony. I slept in a chair for 6 months in my room. I didn't leave my bedroom to go to my living room. That's how bad it was. And I'd never gone through anything that intense before. Like, when people talk about, oh, they want to die or commit suicide, I didn't know what that was until that period of my life. Because I had the option. And I nearly did.
So you did feel like you went there to that place where you're like, this pain is too much. I don't want to be here anymore.
I don't know if anybody has ever had back pain. Please. Your whole life, there's nothing you can do. Your body is, literally, you can't breathe without pain. I didn't have the luxury of coming home and sitting down and say, oh, what a day. Mm. No. I didn't have the luxury of getting up and going to the bathroom. I needed somebody to bathe me. Somebody to wipe me. And this is my big age. Big age and big body. So you can imagine the wahala.
And the indignity.
But she was my very trusted assistant who's now married and gone to Abuja. But she's been with me for about 13 years, 12, 13 years. So she moved back to Lagos to take care of me. Mm. Bathing me, dressing me. So after I've come out of that, I don't take anything for granted, which is why I've made it my point of duty to be positive, because I've seen death and we went toe to toe and I won. Mm. I won. So that's why when people ask me, like, why are you always so happy? I've come from somewhere. Mm. I was in a tunnel for so long, literally just pitch black. And then I began to see shadows. And when you begin to see shadows, it means there's light somewhere. Then it got lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter until I saw the light. But I have been there. Like you, I sat in my room. There are days, Kemi, I would wake up at 6 a.m. and I'm looking at the wall, just staring blank at the wall, and I would cry. The next time I looked at my watch, it was 8 p.m. Wow. All I've done is stare at the wall from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. That was not a life. I would go to the hospital and I could not come out of the car. I'm driving to see the doctor. The doctor is coming out to see me inside the car because I cannot come out of the car.
And how long did this go on for?
For about, it was about almost 2 years. I had 2 epidurals in 1 week. 2 epidural injections in 1 week for pain. Didn't work. Until September of 2019 that I now started my pain management journey, which sort of like led me to where we are now.
So this brings me actually to just talk about your faith a little bit, because I want to ask you what helped you to hold on in those really dark periods. But I also want to tie that back to something that you said at the beginning when you said when you got married, your husband was your first. So you were somebody who were raised, you had your faith, you were a Christian, and given the journey that you've been on now, what role does your faith play? What role did it play in your healing process? And what role does it play now? How do you, sort of live out your faith now?
I consider myself a walking miracle because, it would seem somewhat trivial to somebody else. But in 2017, I had a disc in my neck taken out and replaced. Then I had that calamity in 2018. So I just coming out of surgery on my neck in 2017, into surgery on my back in 2018, into having a bacterial infection in my spine till almost the end of 2019. And it was God every single time. Even the day I had all the pills in my hand, because I was taking 4 kinds of pain medication at the time, and I had all the pills in my hand, and I said, today's the day I'm going to pop all of these pills and just lie down, make my bed where well, my chair, and just sleep off. And I tried to get up to go get something to drink. I didn't have anything to drink beside me.
So I couldn't
get up out of the bed to get something to drink. So I just lay back down. And I believe God used my pain to save my life that day. And after that, I said to myself, okay, so there's nothing really that God can't do. There's nothing. And then my saving grace came from Instagram. He sent somebody who saw me posting still, but posting with the hashtag in a tunnel. And this person sends me a DM, and I was not finding it funny. I was like, who is this person? They've come now. Nonsense. I'm about to delete and block, because I'm a dabber. I dab, delete, and block. I was like, let me just wait. So he now says, hold on, calm down. My name is Dr. So-and-so, and a voice said to me to reach out to you, and I never disobeyed his voice. And that's how he reached out to me. This man, I did not know him from Adam, sent money for my tests, sent money for me to fly to Abuja to see a colleague of his who had just returned from the UK, who diagnosed my problem after seeing me walk up the stairs and said, you know what? And that's what he did. This is how the healing process started. And since then, so God has been more than faithful to me. More than faithful. I don't even know the English to use. I don't know if there's something more than faithful, but he has been faithfuler.
He has been faithfulest.
He has been faithful. That's how he has been. So yeah, God has been faithful to me.
I'm looking at the time, and I know that, they are already signaling me. And meanwhile,
it was chai.
But I wanted to give people in the audience an opportunity to also ask Chioma some questions. Hands up already.
Hello, Chigul.
What up, darling?
First of all, I want to say to everybody who hasn't seen her TEDx talk, to go look for it on YouTube and get the fuller story. That was the first time I actually paid attention to who you were. I knew you from the voice note of I'm not going to be a West, right? And then when I heard the TEDx talk, for someone who had gone through dark clouds that you call in the tunnel, I call it dark clouds. And for certain times in the country that I was in, there was no sun anyway. So there was no getting out of it. And I just want to ask, because I know it's a journey that happens over and over again. For some, they're blessed enough to overcome it and overcome it for good. Some of us haven't. If you have, could you please tell me what you've been able to do to take yourself out of the tunnel and never go back in? Because it's very easy to go back in. And for joy givers, people don't notice when you're in the tunnel because you know you have to put up an act. You have to entertain people. You have to give them what they think they know of you. For me, my style is to not let you see me at all when I cannot be myself. So there's nothing negative to compare it to. So if you see me disappear for 6 months, I'm in the tunnel. When I come out blazing. But who wants to waste 6 months of their life in a year being in the tunnel? So if you've been able to come out and stay out, tell me what works. Because some people say exercise, mingle, find boyfriend. I don't know if you know about the fitness instructor I mentioned on Sunday that had everything and still didn't want to be in this world. That's not the solution. So if you found a way, please teach us.
So what?
Well, I think because of the fact that we're all works in progress. C'est la vie, as the French would say. So the issue is now, how do you navigate those waters when those dark times come? For me, I do a lot of singing. I create, because sometimes that darkness translates into something when I'm writing. So I'll write, I can literally make up, then when I was ill, I used to write film every night. I used to create film. Wonderful film, every night. Because my thoughts would just be running. And so I just channeled it into, what I would think is, what can make me happy right now? I like to sing, so it puts me in a good place. I'll write, it'll put me in a good place. I used to journal at the time. I didn't know about journaling. So what's all this rubbish? I said, oh, you boast of all this writing down your thoughts and your feelings. But I wrote my thoughts and my feelings, and it actually made me feel better. So I think those things help. Find your happy place. Whatever makes you happy all the time, stay in that place.
Okay.
Stay in that place.
I don't have a question. I just wanted to respond to you that medication also works. Because sometimes I think that we over-Christianize things. If it's a medical, clinical depression, please get medication.
I agree.
Hi, Chigo. Thank you so much for your story. I mean, I think I was really inspired. I haven't known much about your story, and I will go look for that YouTube page. Let me ask you this question concerning being a good girl. Because I like to know how, if you've been mad at God at some point, because you know when we make girls feel like they have to be virgins before they get married and be this perfect girl, and then you got married at 33 and then that happened to you and you feel like, listen, I was a good girl. Yeah. What went wrong? Yeah. So did you ever come to a point where you just blamed God for this whole thing? No, this church thing doesn't work. Mm-hmm. It was a scam, and you know what? I'm just falling off the cliff and I'm doing everything I'm going to do because the sex I haven't had in 33 years, guess what? I'm about to have it back to back. Did you have that season? And or if you did not have it, it's okay to tell me you didn't have it.
Yes.
But I'd like to know if you ever blamed God for that season. Thank you.
That's a great question, actually.
Blame God. I always just, and someone said to me, don't say that, because I say to myself, would I advise anybody to hold yourself? Hello? To hold yourself for that long? I don't know. I just said, God, advise me what to tell somebody, because I felt like maybe things would have been better, and I may be wrong. I felt like maybe things would have been better if I knew what I was doing in that area earlier. Maybe I tried a few things with a few human beings before that. Practice, they say, makes perfect. So maybe if I had practiced that time. But I also know that I said to myself that I didn't want to, I wanted it to be my gift to my husband. That's what I said to myself. So I didn't, there was nobody to blame. I made a conscious decision to do it on the wedding night, which we didn't even do because we were very tired. So it wasn't even that night.
You didn't do it because
it was, we were tired. Hello, after wedding day, you are tired. Hello. We went to sleep. Hello. Another day, we gave it a shot. Yeah. So I'm just saying, I felt like that was my way of being, because I was in church all my life. I've been in church all my life. So it wasn't a matter of God. I wasn't angry at him because I made a decision. So when, even when things happened, I said, well, I'm not going to take back how I feel. Would I advise you to do that? That was me. Your story might be different. And some people do it and then become, find Christ after, and they become a, what's the word? Yeah, whatever that English is. After, they close the shop until, you know, yeah. Marriage. So, you know, everybody has sort of like their own ways. I don't think I was ever angry at God. I don't think I ever.
Did you feel, there's, somebody has a, do you have a question here? Okay, somebody has a mic there. Sorry, I just wanted to just follow up on something before I let you have the question. Did you feel, though, that you had, not that mad, whether you, but you, you know, the marriage, with the marriage not working, with not having kids, did you feel like there was no point in
like
holding yourself? Still,
because I was like, I don't want to ever, like, I'm not that person.
Yeah.
I don't do it for exercise. I'm not going to just be anybody. Yeah. Shop is open. Please, hello, come. I don't do such.
Yeah.
So I was like, if I found the person that I, that was going to be my person, then maybe, yeah, we'll consider it. But I'm busy, I think. I keep myself busy so that I don't have to focus on that.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's not really.
I think what I get, what I hear you saying is fundamentally your faith is part of who you are.
Yeah. Yeah.
And your decisions were yours to make. And, you know, having your peace with that means that you don't question, you know, those decisions. And
I
your
don't.
Faith is, you know, so I guess to answer that question, the faith is still, it doesn't.
Very much intact. I'm a lover of Christ.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. Hello, Chigul, and thank you for sharing your story and for being so vulnerable. My concise question is, have you ever been in therapy? And if so, have you found it helpful? If not, why haven't you considered it?
Funny enough, I need it. Okay? Okay? I do need it, yeah. I think it's just telling myself that I'm not ready to be that raw just yet. I feel like I need to be ready to be that raw because I have to be really raw and open and be ready for what somebody's going to tell me. And I have to be ready for that because sometimes you're not ready for the feedback. Like somebody said to me, don't ask a hard question or you're going to get a hard answer. So if you're not ready for the hard answer, don't ask the question. So I feel like I'm getting to the place where it's time for me to talk to someone because you can only but coast for so long. Therapy is seen as a weird thing here on this side where people are saying you don't need to talk to anybody. Why are you talking to somebody? Are you mad? Like, you're not mad. It's just normal. What has happened to you? It's happened to other people. It's not only you. You know, you're made to feel like you are foolish because what's therapy called? That person needs therapy as they're talking to you like that. So I'm going to because I know that I need it. I need to do it. And I will.
Do you think that you've shied away from therapy because maybe it's going to reveal some things or some pain or some deep-seated issues that you haven't wanted to deal with?
I think so because I don't know if many of us are like me, but it is in my older years that I realized my childhood was one kind. Trauma. I had trauma. Like, you didn't know it was trauma. You were just living your life and you're like, that shouldn't have happened to me. Mm. That wasn't nice. That wasn't right. I'm in my 40s,
yeah,
close
absolutely.
To 50. Hello. Mm-hmm. So it's very Son Howley, you know. I'm so sorry. I'm using words that I make up as I go. Son Howley is just But it is. But it, so I'm realizing that there is trauma.
Yeah.
And I have to unpack those boxes. Yeah. They are sealed right now.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to have to unpack those boxes. And what I find inside might not be cute.
Yeah.
But the Lord's going to help us.
Amen.
We're going to get it.
Yeah.
We're going to get it.
Okay, so we have a question here.
Thank you. Hi, Chioma.
Hi.
Thanks so much for sharing so vulnerably about your divorce. I could relate as the first daughter as well, as a good girl, as someone who was a people pleaser. And there's a lot of people who would find themselves in situations where they're in pretty toxic and abusive relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And because of the worry about what people are going to think, what people are going to say, how people are going to perceive them, they stay. They stay because they just think, well, at least here everyone thinks I'm happy, and they live these lies. What advice would you give to someone who's in that situation about the freedom they don't know about yet that lies behind making that choice to leave that situation?
You have to, once you make the decision that where you are is not where you want to be or where you should be, and you see where you want to be, just go there. Literally, it's a decision. You have to be able to block out the noise in the market and face your forward, face your front, and know that this is for my well-being, this is for my mindset, this is for my mental health. Not anybody else's, because you cannot be of use to anybody when you're a mess. You have no use to your children. You have no use to your family members. You become a shadow of yourself, all because you are trying to keep up appearances. Is it not better to be by yourself than to be somebody and be unhappy? You're by yourself, a happy unit, than you're supposed to have somebody who's supposed to be helping you through life and they're making life difficult. What's the point? Who are you deceiving? Anybody can lie to you, but you cannot lie to yourself. So you just face your front. You know where you want to go. Go there. It's hard, and it seems it's not as easy as I'm saying it, but it's a process.
Mm.
But the first one is knowing where I need to be and knowing that where I am is not good. That's the first thing, knowing.
I think it fits very well with our theme, where you were, where you are, where you want to be, connecting the dots.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Toyin.
Chioma, thank you so much for sharing your story.
Welcome.
I did watch your TED talk some years back, and I do encourage everyone else here to watch it if you haven't seen it. I have a very quick question. Your people-pleasing personality, would you say that stemmed from your relationship with your mother? Because you were both so different, you wanted to please her, you wanted to be like her, or perhaps people compared the two of you and wanted you to be like her? I don't know.
I mean, I think my mother, because even when I first did Chigul, my mother didn't understand her. Because she was like, why is she so razz? Like, so we would go out and she'd be like, which voice are you doing today? Like, which one are you showing them today? Yes, which character? So if I was emceeing a wedding, I didn't like going to weddings that my mother or my aunties would be at. Because I will have to first start with a good, hello, ladies and gentlemen, my mother's in the audience, I have to be behaved properly, so I'm just going to say hello first, and hello, how are you, thank you very much, and then, okay, good evening, yeah, then I just switch. But I think growing up and being in university in America was literally what did it, because I was doing everything for everyone and saying yes to everybody, and I just carried on after that. So even as a teacher, I became a yes teacher to my students. And that's when I realized, this isn't really the best place to be. So it was from that point. Because growing up, I had a really, really cool childhood. I mean, my mother was not like me, but I think I was just a funny one in the house. So hey, I enjoyed my crown as a funny one in the house. I was the light bringer. I brought laughter to the house. That was my job. And I took it very seriously. But saying yes to everybody, it happened more like when I was in secondary school, from military school to... Because military school, you didn't argue. It's yes, it's obey before complain. I was in military school for 4 years. We were full on, we're treated like military people. And my father was in the Air Force, so it was one of those situations. I just always said yes, and I always did what I was told. Always.
All right. Okay, so I think one more question, and then that would be all, because they've told me that. Tayo, while Tayo is talking, before she talks, I wanted to ask you, just following up maybe on Tony's question, but, you know, was your father was also, you know, hard on you, especially with trying to get you to, you know, do better in school. Did you find that you were able to take it more easily from your dad? Because sometimes I feel like girls, we do the daddy's girl thing, and daddy can do no wrong, but mommy's voice is always the more critical voice in your head. Whereas if you look at it objectively, both of them are, you know, hard on you, maybe.
I mean, weirdly enough, my father was very strict.
Yeah.
People who knew us and my family, like, my father was very strict. Mm. Like, my father did not believe that we should be outside of the house when the sun has gone down. If the night is coming, you are going home. Mm. Let me not catch you outside. I got my last flogging at 17 because I went out and came back by 10 p.m. He beat us, Banza. He flogged me, Banza. As in, I see Philippine now, so I'm thinking about it. So, my father was a strict military man. Everybody knew him. Everybody was afraid of him. Because my father could, when he tells you, like, my father would, he didn't even say, oh, if you do bad in school, you're going to the village. That was just, we just knew. You go to the village and go to school there. So you didn't want to do that, so you just try. Mm. But my mother would even try and be a little bit more lenient. So I think she was more lenient than
so
my
then
dad.
Why do you feel like you still had a more contentious relationship with your mom than with your dad? Is, I guess, what I'm asking.
I think growing up, especially with things like my marriage falling apart and being fat, and I'm sorry, I use fat. People say plus size, heavy set. No, the word is fat. Let's be going. So, yeah, being that way. So, those things, but I realized later in life, it was like she just didn't want me to be sick, or she didn't want me to be unhealthy. So, all those things came from a very good place. But we just clashed at the time.
Yeah.
At the time.
Tayo, and then that will be the last question.
Okay. Hi, Chioma. So, I think this is the perfect last question. It's not even quite a question. It's actually a request. Could you kindly do your different personalities for us, even as we round up? So your different accents and your different, you know, just, I think it's a perfect way to round up.
I have some fans there. It's actually, sing. Say, wait, hold on first.
Tayo preempted me. I had already whispered to her.
Awesome.
So, and Sister Ego is here. So there are people who have been following my madness for a long time, and people who know me from house. So I have 13 characters that I created. Don't clap. Some people think it's madness.
13 of them are living in your head.
In my head. So we have Chigul. Hello. Yeah. So she do the one that you know. She said turns like this. Hello, good evening. How are you? Yeah. So she's the one that have you know, she coordinates. Yeah. She's the one that has some money. Yeah. So she's the one normally that goes to event, you know, and do her. I do her. So this her. Then I'm sorry. I forget where I am. Then there's a gay on the stand. Name is Modinot. Yeah. She's nude, you understand? Her name is Modinot. She have master. You understand? She have bachelor master. Yeah. She have 2 degrees. You understand? Yeah, that is her. Then
there's that very posh lady.
We're going to her. The thing about it is, I was, you know, her name's Lady Catherine, and you know, she's from the city of Poshbury, and she lives at Poshbury Manor, and darlings, you know, and she's the one that, you know, she talks about, you know, when you see someone for the first time, you say hello. She says no, it's not hello, it's hello. And she says, how do you say it? She says, you know, you put 3 things together. What's on your head? Hair. What do you breathe in and out? Air. And a fox lives in his lair. So you put them all together, you say, hello. That's how you do it.
You have the American one.
There's a little boy, his name is Devin, yeah? And he likes the color red, yeah? He likes to play outside with his mum, yeah? And he goes, mum, go and play outside. And she goes, yeah. And he goes, all right. Yeah, my name's Devin. Hello, how you doing? All right, yeah. So that's Devin. And then there is, so that's 2 British people. Then there's Taquanero. Listen.
Linda. So Taquan Netta, like, she got like an opinion about her thing, right? Like, she be like, listen, let me talk to you about this for a minute. Wait, like, ah. That's her, right? Then, Rem Sweetwater. Her name is Carlethia Sweetwater. Carlethia, why? Because she was born in a car. Don't you judge her. That's her name, Carlethia. Yeah, and she, you know, she got the heavy word from on high because the Lord speak through her. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Uh-huh, you got to catch the revelation. Ha-ha. That's what she do. That's what she do. And then, there's Miss Doreen, who's from the South, and she don't take no nonsense. She like, listen, let me talk about something here. Say, listen here. Listen, come close, honey. Let me tell you about this thing. Y'all sitting here in this hall. I don't know why y'all do this here. I don't know. I don't understand that. So that's how she do. She talk like that. That's her name. Her name is Miss Doreen. All right? All right. That's Miss Doreen. then there's Juanita Chiquita. She's a little, she's some from Puerto Rico. Okay? She's a Boricua Morena. Okay? So sometimes when you come to her, she's going to tell you what you want, okay? She like, what do you want me to do for you? I'm for you, okay? Yes. That's her name, okay? Then there's Dolores, who talks like this. She's from New Jersey. She's like, talk about it. She has a son who's like, you know, he's a doctor. And he's married to another girl, and she's like a doctor as well. And they have matzo balls for dinner, and they live in New Jersey, across the way, across the bridge. Yeah, talk about it. Talk amongst yourselves. All right, let's go. Let's do it. That's how she talks. Yes. And who else? Let me see. And then there's Mrs. Patel. Mrs. Patel is domestic goddess. She work in telecoms. She have 4 daughters, and she sometimes liking to stay at home and making parathis and dal. You like parathi, she like parathi too. She make for her husband and the children. Everybody's eating parathis. Is that it?
That's okay. Is that it?
She's gonna sing. Because I already saw that she's going to sing one song before we go.
We still have some small time. Some. What you want to sing? Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Oblige them. The mic shuffle.
Okay, so, you know that I'm a singist, yeah? Anything you do, just add east. If you like to cook, you're a what? A cookist. If you like to read, you're a what? If you like to steal, you're a what? AKA thief. Yeah. So I'm a singist, and I like to write songs that's captivate, you know? So sometimes, when I'm with myself, I ask myself questions. I say, Chigo, Chigo, say, ah? I say, I'm going to write a song. It's okay. So now this song I'm going to sing for you now. It's a song that came to me in Lapon Bay. Then I was on my bed in Uruquil. That means under blanket. Then I was under blanket. I was just thinking to myself, Chigo, what are we going to do? I said, I don't know. So this song came to me because I think to myself that I don't want to be a West. A West is somebody who sits down, who do dream and wait for it to come on your lap. Yeah. You don't want to be a West, okay? So I'm going to sing this song now. Please don't tape it, okay? I have a CD coming out very soon with 42 hits on it. Yeah. The song is simple. It simply say, I'm not gonna be a West. I'm not gonna be a West. People are hustling, you are dreaming, you are a West. People are hustling, you are sleeping, you are a West. I'm not gonna be a West. Sit down there. I'm not gonna be a West. Don't let your life be a West. You sound good.
Sing proper song now. I mean, I wanted to do a proper song. This is a West.
Well, I just think it shuts this thing. Summertime and the living is easy. Elisha jumping, and the cotton is high. Your daddy's rich, and your ma is good looking. So hush, little baby, and don't you cry.
When they say multi-talented, Lomo, and then somebody says she's not brilliant, somebody says she's not intelligent, somebody says she's not smart, and this person grew up thinking she's not smart, she's the dumb one. Meanwhile, God has deposited extra. That's how you know that the devil even knows what God has put inside you. That's why he comes when you are very young and tries to stifle you and attack you. But you know, clearly, please, can we give another round of applause? Thank you, Chioma. Thank you for honoring my invitation. Thank you for coming on this stage, Kuramo and Chrystallis stage. Thank you for being so authentic. You know, people see just one side of you, but today I think you showed us the woman behind the character, the Chioma behind Chigul. And I'm, you know, I hope that everyone who's here has been inspired like I have been. I think you've shown me, if I have to say for me, it's, you know, how to just be authentically me and to be unapologetically me and to be a joy bringer, to be selfish about bringing joy to myself but also to everyone, and to really be nurturing about that joy. So thank you so much. And I just want to say, so the gifts, we have some gifts for you, Chioma, courtesy of IMAZ. Courtesy of our sponsor, IMAZ. So please help me say thank you to IMAZ. And we also have a goodie bag for you that has some gifts from some of our other partners. Olori. Shampoo and conditioner from Olori. We have some House of Tara products in there. And then we have from Modera. Some of you would have won gifts from Modera, some body oils and body products, and you have a box of products from Modera. So, yes. So thank you everyone again. I just wanted to say thank you.